Have you done 270 yet?
Yes.
So normally, there's this idea of a do no harm state. So when a system boots up, you'd like to set it up in a way so that if you have things hooked up to it, it's not going to blow something up before you run your code. So if you let your I/O pins be outputs by default, or randomly go to outputs, it's possible that, you know, you've got an input connected to that and it starts pushing 5 volts out that pin, and it might damage something that's connected to it. So setting up a pin to be an input is the safer option. Because if it's supposed to be an output, well, if you have an LED hooked up to an input, it's not going to do any harm. It's just not going to supply anything to the LED. So my guess is that when you boot, probably those pins are set to inputs, all things being equal. But once you set it to an output, if you exit, I think it'll probably stay an output until something changes it. So, and that's a common thing you'll find in microprocessors, is this idea of what state you want to start in. Is this do no harm or do less harm state, maybe. All right, so let's start. Other PA2 questions. Okay. That's fair. So I'll post ODP 304 tomorrow morning, and that's just practice using a scanner to do some input and bundle it in a class. So the README is already under /temp, but I haven't actually opened it up yet. So that'll open tomorrow morning at 8. All right, let's look at the lab. So lab 2, you're going to work with these things, you're going to actually hook them up to some physical devices. Okay, and in particular, you're going to make an LED blink. So that's kind of the hardware version of Hello World, usually. Make an LED turn on and off. There's a lot of detail in here, but this is pretty straightforward if you follow all the steps. Okay, but the steps are all critical. And most of the time when somebody comes to me and says, you know, my Pi is broken, my code's not working right, it's because they didn't follow one of the steps. So let's talk through this. Experiment 1, basically you're going to write a short Java program that lets the user type in something and hit enter. And if what they type is the number 1, then you want to turn an LED on. You're going to hook an LED into here. And if they type anything other than a 1, you want to turn the LED off. And then go back and let the user type something else in. So from the keyboard, they can turn the LED on or off by typing a 1 enter or typing, say, a 0 enter or anything that's not 1. Okay, and it's a basic exploration of driving voltage levels through these ports, okay, by way of making an LED blink. So let's talk about how you hook up your LED first of all. So we're going to connect to a line that's called GPIO4. Okay, GPIO is general purpose IO. And most devices, most micros have GPIO lines. So here's a picture of the connection points. There's 40 of them, which is the 40 holes on the side of this. And GPIO4 is down here on pin 16. Okay, so where's pin 16? It's a little hard to decipher, but if you look closely on the side of your unit, you'll see a number 1 and a number 2 embossed above and below on this side of the connector. Okay, so that's how you find pin 1 and 2, and then it continues to alternate 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 39, 40. Okay, so from the side view, it's going to look something like this. Here's your thing with all your holes. And this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 39, 40. Here's your USB plug. Okay, so it's like that. So GPIO4 is pin 16. And pin 14 is ground. So you have two holes right next to each other that can be used to connect an LED to ground and to GPIO4. So pin 14, this is ground. This is GPIO4, so what you want to do is put an LED between them in the right orientation. And now if you output 5 volts on pin 16, that should turn your LED on. If you output 0 volts, it should turn your LED off.
Why is that ground pin diagram white while the others are black?
Don't know. Are there other ground pins that are white? Huh, I don't know. I don't know what any of the colors mean. I'm guessing blue is ITC and red is 5 volts and orange is kind of 5 volts, but it's only 3.3 volts. I'm guessing that should be black, but I don't know.
Orange pin is having an off day.
Yeah, it's having an off day, exactly. And yeah, yellow is ITC. Blue is also ITC. Yeah, so I didn't pay a lot for this picture. I ripped it from the web, so get what I pay for. That's a good question. I didn't even notice there were colors there. All right, so lab write-up. Where'd my lab go? Oh, I'm in the lab. Okay. All right, so here's some code for driving the GPIO lines. This is not the program you need for experiment one, okay? This is just some code snippets, but you will need these code snippets, but you need to put some other code in yourself. Okay, if you run this, it's not gonna do anything. Okay, so here are the critical pieces. First of all, an import statement. This is how you get to the library. It's called Pi4J, Pi4Java. Is the name of the library. So import all of this stuff. That makes these other things work. It gives you access to these other classes. So two main pieces of initialization. This one here creates what's called a GPIO controller. So from that import class, you'll have access to the class GPIO controller. GPIO is just the name I chose for the object. You can call it anything you want. And then call gpiofactory.getInstance. That basically gives you an interface to the GPIO subsystem, okay, through this object, in this case GPIO. And then one thing I can do with that is I can condition pins. So I can say gpio.provisionDigitalOutputPin, and I can use an argument of raspbpin.gpio_04. All this formatting is absolutely critical, okay? The only thing you can wiggle around here is the name of the factory, GPIO, and the name of the pin. Okay, but all of this stuff has to be pretty much verbatim, and that's going to return an object of type GPIO pin digital output. Once you have that pin object, you can say pin high and pin low, and in this case it will drive this output pin GPIO4 to either 5 volts or 0 volts. That's all you need to get out of the box. Okay, so anywhere in your code after you do this, if you say pin.high, you get 5 volts out. If you say pin.low, you get 0. So in this lab, all we're doing is hooking up an LED to that. But we could be doing other things. If you want to be nice when you're done, do gpio.shutdown. But it should reclaim the resources when you exit anyway. Okay, so you need to write additional code to basically read from standard in, use scanner on system.in. I would use next line. You could use next int if you want, if you're only putting in zeros and ones, or use next line and check to see if they type in a one or something different from a one, and call pin.high or pin.low, go back to the top, just throw it in an infinite loop. If you want to throw an exit command in, you can do that. You can do whatever you want, right? The goal is to make the LED blink. Make sense so far? Yeah.
So only the one can turn on the LED. Anything else turn it off, right?
Yeah.
Even the letters?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's up to you how you want to do it. So the important part is that from the keyboard, you can hit something and make the LED turn on. You can hit something else and make it turn off. Right? And whoever you demonstrate this to, you want to be able to show them that. Right? So I hit this and it turns on. I hit this, it turns off. And unless you're showing it to me, right, I'm not going to be trying your code out or anything like that. So that's why it's kind of an approximate description. All right. Next critical piece, how do you compile your C program? You can't just say Java C. You got to put in all this other stuff. So there's a dash CP, that's the class path switch. This says, where should I look for class files? Because when you compile, it needs to know the information about some of the classes you're using. So CP says, you can look in my current directory, that's the period. And if you don't find what you need there, check this. And this is a jar file, okay? It's an archive of classes. And it comes with the Py4j library, and it has all those things like, all those classes that we used in the code. So it's the usual command with this extra switch, dash cp space, and then all of this stuff. And then whatever your program is, .java, that you want to compile. And that will create a .class file, in this case, my file name .class. All right, hook up your LED. Run your code, and to run it, you need to use a special command. Again, you can't just say Java, my program. You've got to say sudo, it's got to be run as a super user, and you've got to use a class path switch. So sudo java-cp, all of that stuff, and then the name of your class. And that should execute. Does that make sense, or is that clear? Doesn't have to make sense, but it should. Right? So this is all stuff that's giving you access to the classes you need from the Py4j library. All right, so when you're done, you run your program, you hit a 1, it turns on, you hit a 0, it turns off, you're good to go. Move on to experiment 2. Experiment 2 is the autonomous version of this. So your LED is going to blink all by itself, half second on, half second off. Okay, so you run your experiment 2 program, and the LED just starts blinking. You don't have to type anything. Okay, how do you do that? You use a delay routine. So this code right here will give you a method called mySleep, which lets you sleep a certain number of milliseconds. So if you put this code in your class, okay, so you've got a class with your main program, somewhere in there, put this code in, right? It's not part of your main, but it's part of your class, so it's another method in your main class file. Then if you call mySleep parentheses 500, that'll delay half a second. So how do you write program 2? Call pin.high, call mySleep 500, call pin.low, mySleep 500, go back to the top, do it forever. Let's just throw that in a while forever loop. Is that clear? All right, experiment 3, almost like experiment 2, but instead of just being 500 milliseconds, the program begins by asking the user how long of a delay they want. You type in a number, hit enter, and then it runs experiment 2's code, but it delays that long. So if you say 100 and hit enter, it'll blink on and off really fast. If you say 2000, it'll be 2 seconds on, 2 seconds off, and so on. Okay, so this is all kind of warm up, but it's gets you out of the box, gets you interacting with actual hardware, which is a good step. All right, so when you're done, you want to demonstrate all of this to someone in the lab, a lab assistant, myself, Izad, and you can always grab anybody that you see. If Izad's in his office, he's fair game. I'm fair game. And here's your sign-off sheet. So put in your group number, the date, full name of all the members in your group, and then have them witness experiment 1. So run your code, turn it on, turn it off, right? They see that, they can sign on the witness line, run experiment 2, it blinks, they can sign off. Experiment 3, you can run it, put in 100, blinks fast, put in 2000, blinks slow, they sign off on that, you're done.
So should we print that off and then scan it back in?
Yeah. Unless you're going to forge their stuff. No. And every lab will have a sign-off sheet like this. So. All right, and your lab write-up, right, just talk about what you did, put the code in there, any particular observations, any peculiarities, things like that, and sign-off sheet. Yes?
So can I get signature from you and Isa?
There's other lab assistants in there, so Patrick is in there on Fridays. And I think there's some other people throughout the week. If it's a real problem, let me know. Like if you're there at some time when there's absolutely no coverage, and I may let other people sign off on it. But I mean, I trust you, right? It's just practice for doing this.
Are any of the other professors there again? Like Carol's around or?
Yeah, probably. I mean, understanding that if they're busy or they don't want to do it, that's fine.
Yeah.
So no obligation. But the way I've done this, right, I have a little description of what exactly they should be doing. So they don't need to know anything about, you know, the lab itself, the setup, and so on. They just need to see that it blinks, sign off on it. That's fine. And I switched my lab hours to Monday. So I'm in the lab Monday from 9 to 10 and from 11 to 12. And then Friday from 10 to 11. And then Fridays 11 to 12 is our usual Section A on Friday, so I'm available then also. But not this Friday. I won't be around Friday, so. All right, other questions on this? And in general, if you're planning to find me somewhere, check engrcs.com/schedule, because I update that with my hours. So Friday I'm going to be out of town, so that should be reflected. That's my only planned absence, though, this quarter. All right, so that's lab two. And the labs will go every other week, and they'll alternate with programming assignments. So let me give you a preview of where the other labs are going. So lab three is going to be very similar to lab two with one subtle difference, which is while the LED is blinking, the user can type in a new number, hit enter, and it will start blinking at that new rate. So it'll blink at a half a second, but while it's doing that, they can type in 100, hit enter, and now it blinks fast. And then they can type in 5,000, hit enter, and now it blinks 5 seconds on off. And while it's doing that, they can put in 50, and it'll blink super fast, and so on. And that's surprisingly tricky to do in something like C. Because in C, when you do an fgets, everything in your program stops. Right? If you say fgets buffer, the next line of code doesn't run until the person hits enter. So how would you make an LED blink while also waiting for the user to type in a new number? And there's not an easy way to do that in C. It'll turn out there's a really easy way to do it in Java, which is by using threads. So we'll actually have two parallel processes running in our Java code, one that's blinking the LED and one that's looking for new blink rates from the user. So that'll be our motivation for learning about threads. Lab four will deal with input. So we'll hook a button up to an input port, and every time you hit the button, you'll increment a counter. And you'll find that when you press the button, typically the counter increments by 4 or 5 or 10, because these buttons are noisy. When you close a contact, it usually bounces and makes multiple contacts and breaks multiple times. So we'll write software to debounce a switch, basically. And it's a classic thing to do when you're interfacing a microprocessor is deal with noisy inputs. So we'll learn about debouncing in lab four. Lab five is where you build a network. So you'll work with pairs of groups. You'll pick another group to work with. And you'll take your two Raspberry Pi Zeros and you'll run three wires between them. You'll connect ground and two GPIOs. And you'll use that to send messages from one unit to another. So I'll give you a simple protocol to implement. You'll implement a protocol, build a bit of a communication stack, put a application layer on top, and be able to say, hello world, and it should show up on the other person's Pi. So that'll be lab five. I made it optional last time. I don't know if it'll be optional this time. It was like extra credit. But it's a fun
fun experiment to do.
Yes, our own interweb. All right, so questions on labs. All right, so we're going to spend today playing with Eclipse. And up through the break, I want to talk about some basics of using Eclipse, dealing with workspaces, refactoring, importing and exporting, stuff you need for submitting PA2, and I want to talk about Java documentation. And then, probably after the break, I want to start talking about graphical interfaces and how we can use Eclipse and a window class called Swing and a tool called Window Builder to start making graphical interfaces. And PA3 will involve using a graphical interface. And this is not like Xenity, okay? This is full bore, genuine, bona fide GUIs, okay, with complete control over it, the appearance and the behavior of these things. So that'll be good stuff. So does everybody here have Eclipse installed on their machine or have a plan for accessing Eclipse? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, if you don't have Eclipse or have a plan, you need one. And last resort, right, you can run Eclipse on the machines in the collaboratorium. That means you gotta do your Java coding on campus, and that's fine. But if you have access to your own machine, right, go ahead and install Eclipse, and if you're having trouble with that, let me know, and I'll help you get it going. So normally when you run Eclipse for the first time, it's going to ask you for a workspace. And the idea of a workspace is it's sort of the parent directory in which all of your projects are going to be placed. Okay, and when you create one Java project, you're going to have a number of files that you create. Okay, usually one file per class. You're going to have class files that are derived from those. You're going to have various support files that are created. You might have documentation files, and so on and so forth. And each of these things come under a whole directory tree, and that tree is rooted inside whatever you specify the workspace to be. So first suggestion is make sure this workspace is somewhere that you feel secure about. Okay, if you're on Windows and you take the default, it's somewhere in some directory tree that if your machine goes south and you rebuild, it's probably going to be lost. So make this some area that you're backing up frequently, okay? Something that you're pushing out to Git or you're sticking on a flash drive or something, okay? Because this is really the source of all the work that you're going to do in Eclipse. And if you lose that directory, you lose all your work. Right, except what you've backed up. So pick a safe place for that, a place that you're comfortable with. And then the next thing you're going to want to do is set your perspective, and you only have to do this once. And it'll default to that workspace every time you start Eclipse. So if you're sticking with one workspace, you only have to do that once. And you have to set your perspective once. So remember, window perspective, open perspective, other, and find Java. And that gives you a standard looking.
And actually there's a button on the top, very top right, that allows you to do the same thing. The left button.
Open perspective, cool. All right, so then you should come to a location like this. And normally there won't be any projects in there. I've got one project sitting around. Okay, so let's make a project. Okay, so file, new Java project, and give it a name, something hopefully meaningful, like test. And most of the time, I'm just going to take defaults. So now there's a project, and if you were to click on this, there's all of that stuff that's part of the runtime environment, and there's a folder called source with nothing in it. All right, next thing, try to keep only one project open at a time. If you want to work with another project, right-click on test and say close project. Okay, and if there's no little triangles next to these, all my projects are closed. You can double-click to open it. If you have two projects open at once, it's like an MP lab. It kind of makes things confusing sometimes. Okay, next thing you're going to do is make classes, and there's a little C button here you can use to create it, or you can say right-click new class. And you're generally going to have some sort of main class, which will include a main program. So I can call it my main program, and I'm going to say generate a public static void main, just for fun, and finish. And so there's a stub of some code. And let's make our vector class. So let's do a new class, and I'm going to call this class vector. Now if you make it lowercase, it's going to warn you that by convention, Java names usually start with an uppercase, so I would stick to that convention. So I'll call it vector, and I don't want a public static void main in here, so I'll just say finish. And so now I've got two files in my source directory, and I've got two tabs up here. And it's putting these in a package called test. That's fine. Okay, next comment. If I go into my directory tree, and for me, I did my workspace under Eclipse, delete me. There's my project. It's called test. If I go into there, I've got a source directory. If I go into there, there's a test package. If I go into there, there's my Java code. Okay, don't monkey around with any of this stuff outside of Eclipse. If you really want to read some of the stuff in here to like make a backup or something, that's harmless. But as soon as you change anything, rename, move around, you can break your workspace basically. And when you go into Eclipse, it will say, you know, you're missing a file or there's a bad link or something, and you can hose your whole project. So I would avoid doing anything with your workspace directory tree outside of Eclipse. Okay, other than backing it up. All right, so let's make a vector class. So it's already created my template here for the whole class. So let's make a constructor. And it's doing a lot of typing for me. I put a left bracket, and when I hit enter, it creates a matching right bracket, and it indents. And I'm just going to write some code. And I don't know why it's indenting all of that. So I need some variables up here. Oh, yeah, you're right. Cares. All right, so there's our constructor. It stores this stuff, and let's make a toString. String method. And let's just throw in one more method. Let's make an add method. So the add method's going to take an argument, which is also a vector. It's going to add them together and return the new vector. So Let's just return new vector x plus arg dot x. Okay, thank you. So this is a vector return. And I messed something up. Okay. So there's my vector class. And it's kind of random code because we're just gonna mess around with it. So let's use this in our main program. So we'll make vector v1 and v2. V1's a 1, 2, 3. V2 is 4, 5, 6. And then we'll add them together. And then let's print them out. So I keep control S-ing to save things often. So you can run with the classic play button, or you can go under run, same thing. So run it and your output appears down here in the console window. Okay, so no big surprises there. Yes?
Can you show us how to do debugging?
Yes, we'll do that. Yeah, let's do some debugging. So under Window, Perspective, open Perspective, switch to Debug. And you get this different view of things. And let's go into our vector code and let's debug our, well, there's not a whole lot to debug. Now there's some stuff to debug. All right, so come over here and you can double click and make a breakpoint. So I've got a breakpoint at the beginning of this line right here. And let's go ahead and run. And, can't just run. So you gotta go into run and you gotta say debug. So F11 instead of control F11. And it will run and it stops at this breakpoint right here. So up here we can look at our variables. So this is a vector and arg is another vector, internal ID 16 and 17. I can right click or left click on this and I can see the fields X, Y, and Z, which are 1, 2, 3. I can expand arg and that's got X, Y, Z equal to 4, 5, 6. And I can single step. So under run, I can say step over, so F6 also gets you there. And now I've executed this one instruction, and there's my new X, and I can see it's equal to 5. Okay, that's enough to really get you going, right? So you can set breakpoints, you can examine variables, you can step forward, and then if you want, you can continue running, you can resume, and that takes you through to the next breakpoint or an error or completion. And it's nice because it's built into Eclipse, right? So it understands the environment that you're in. So it's got access to all your variables and methods and things like that. And when you're done and you want to get out of debug, just go back to your default perspective. So switch back to Java. All right, thanks, that was a good one. All right, other questions? So the next thing I want to go over is importing and exporting. So to submit your assignments to Canvas, you're going to want to export. And you're going to export into a zip file, and you're going to upload that to Canvas. You got to do this in a very particular way. Okay, and after we talk about exporting, I'll show you how I'm going to import your zip file. So absolutely, before you finish PA2, upload it to Canvas, you're not done. You want to pull that zip file back down. You want to import it into a new workspace and make sure that the import works. Okay. I hate to say it, but probably like 10% of the submissions I get will not import correctly. And that's going to ding you, you know, the 20 points for not being on time, plus, you know, the rest of the points if you don't happen to catch it and fix it in the next 24 hours. So you really want to figure out this import-export. Okay, so let me show you how to export first. So go on to test, right-click, so your project has to be open, right-click, export. And you want to open up General, and you're going to do Archive File. Okay, so open your project, right-click, export, General, Archive File. And then say Next. And you should see something that looks like this. It should have your project name and then class path and project, and everything should be checked. Okay, if it's not checked, cancel this, try it again. If it's still not checked, go ahead and check these, okay? These are unchecked. That's not what you want. You want them filled in. That should be the default. Okay, and then browse to wherever you want to put the export file. So let's stick it under downloads, and let's call this test export, not text, test. All right, leave everything else the same. Okay, I don't know what these things do. If you click them, we're all doomed. So don't click anything. So pick your export file, say finish. Okay, and that should give you a zip file. So I did it under downloads, test export. Now if you go and look at that, you should see something like this. Okay, there should be a folder for settings, a folder for bin, a folder for source, and then a couple of hidden files. And if you were to look under source, you should see your Java code. But again, you don't want to mess with this stuff. Okay, you can copy this file and save it somewhere, and if it's a good export, it'll get you back to your whole project. But this is the zip file you're going to upload. If all it has is the .java files, that's not a good export. Okay, I'm not going to be able to use that. Need all this other information. Okay, so you do that, you upload the zip file to Canvas, you're just about done. Pull it back down, make sure you can import it. Here's how you import. So let me close out this project. So right-click and close project. All right, totally different process for importing. So File, Import, and under General, but this time, instead of saying Archive, you're going to say Existing Projects into Workspace. Okay, it's a totally different process. We export by doing Archive File. We import existing projects into Workspace. And then you have to come over here, and instead of where it says select root directory, you have to say select archive file. Browse to your archive. So home downloads and test export. And I'm going to get an error. It's going to say some projects cannot be imported because they already exist in the workspace. So I'm trying to import this project that's named test, but I already have a project named test in here, and it's not going to let me overwrite it. Okay, that's a good thing. So if you're not getting this error, something went wrong. So before I can actually do the import, I need to get rid of this current version of my project. Now, if you like gambling, you could just delete it, but I don't recommend that. Okay, so let's rename it. And in Eclipse, there's a concept of refactoring. It's a way that you can do things like rename files or variables. But it's not just a blind go through and substitute when you match a regular expression. It understands the context of things and it'll do a smarter substitution. So if you try to rename a variable from height to rectangle height, and you have the word height somewhere in quotation marks, it won't change it, right? It'll only change it when it thinks it's actually a variable. So to change the name of this project test, we can refactor it. So open it up, and you can just double click it, right click and refactor, and we can pick rename. And let's just call it test original. And now I'm gonna close this. Now I'm going to try to import my zip file. So same process, file, import, existing project, select archive file, test export.zip. I'm going to say finish. And there's the project that I just imported. And if I look at that under the source, I've got two projects. There's the main program. There's the vector class. Everything looks great. I can run it. Click on the main program, run it, everything looks fine, you're good to go. Okay, anytime that you're submitting something, whether it's an assignment or a grant proposal or an application for a fellowship or an internship or something, right, you gotta be really careful about the submission process. Most of the time, humans aren't touching these things until they're several steps removed from what you've done, right? So if you try to submit something and you're missing a file that's required, it may never actually get to a human. It may just get bounced by the submission system. And you may not know about it until 3 weeks after the deadline when you say, hey, what's the status of my application? And they say, we've never heard of you, right? So this is just one of these things. It's where we're sort of interfacing our human work with automated interface, and it's always potentially tricky. So this is nice because it lets you pull it back down and double check, but sometimes you don't have that option, right? You submit and hopefully the system at least sends you an email and says, you know, thank you for your submission, click here if you want to review it. And you can click through and say, did all five files make it, right, or whatever. But it's something that you'll bump into again and again. All right, some other warning I was going to give you about Eclipse, because I don't remember what it was. Don't have more than one project open, but there was something else. I'll tell you when I think of it. All right, so questions on submission or re-importing. All right, talk about documentation. So I wrote, I think, a grand total of one comment in this whole thing that I developed up here, right? And so at the last minute I have to type in my comments and get lots of typos and hopefully not break my code because I deleted a semicolon somewhere. But you want to document as you go, right? I keep telling you that. But if you're developing in Eclipse, it makes it very easy to add comments. Now, it's not going to comment things like this. Right? Because it doesn't know why I said let's store this sum in another variable, okay? But it will do a lot of commenting for you. So for example, in the very beginning of the class, if I go to the line right before it and I say slash star star and I hit an enter, it will give me a little comment block. And it uses Nick as my name. But you can set what you wanted to use for your name. You can tell it that you want to include other information in there, your company and things like that. And it'll pop that in for you, right? So you can customize a header block and you can get it there by typing slash star star enter. And then you can also type in other comments up here. So this is test of a vector class to demonstrate Eclipse type features. Demonstrate, good. And spell checking. All right. When you have a constructor, same thing. Right before the constructor, I can say slash star star, and it creates another header block for me. But now it's got this at sign param, and it lists the three parameters that I'm passing to the constructor, x, y, and z. And so construct a new vector. And down here, I can say the x coordinate, the y coordinate, z coordinate, and this is a right-handed coordinate system. All right, and down here I have a method, slash star star, and there's another block of comments. And this one has an at return tag, which it will use to let me document what the return from this method is. So, method to add to vectors, arg is vector to add, and return is the resulting sum vector. All right, and toString, let's go ahead and comment that. Well, let's not. Let's just leave it at this. All right, so I've got these comments in here, right, and hopefully some other good comments on the code itself. So under project, there's an option which says generate Java doc. So click on that. And if this is not, this should be filled in if you installed Java correctly. If not, you have to find a program called Java doc, but it's in the same directory that usually Java C is. So I'm gonna leave all of this stuff at a default, and I'm just gonna say finish. And it wants to know, yeah, just say yes. It's just talking about where to store the result. So it'll print out some messages generating this and that and this other thing. And now I've got some documentation pre-built for me. So if I want to find it in my normal directory tree, I can go to my workspace. So delete me and test. And there's a folder called doc. And if I look under there, there should be an index.html. I remember my second warning I was going to give you. Don't put spaces inside your path names or your file names ever, at least if you're on Windows. Don't ever do it. Just don't, right? It messes up some software. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. So put in underscores if you want space, or use camel case. But avoid spaces. So let's look at index.html. And it's this nice page of documentation. So it says there's a class named vector. I can click on that. Here's a description of my class. So vector is an object. There's my description of it. There's the author, which would hopefully be something more descriptive. Here's the methods. And I can click on the add method and see the details of it. So that's the parameter, and this is what it returns, and so on. And it's a nice standardized format, right? Everybody using Java understands this format. They know where to find things and so on. And so that's useful. And in Eclipse, there's a folder down here, doc, that you can also look at. So we can open up index.html. And you can see the documentation in here also. And this is really useful as you're developing your code. You've got a position list and you can't remember what the name of some method was. If you've been doing this as you go to your doc, you find the class for position list, and there's a list of all the methods and all the fields and how to use it and so on. Right? Now you don't need your sheet of paper that you scribble down the names of all your functions and stuff so that you can remember them. You've got documentation right there inside Eclipse. Okay, so let this work for you. Okay, don't fight it. it really can make your development process more streamlined and make you more efficient. Right, and it does half the writing for you. Really, you really just have to fill in the essential details. So I'm not going to require a Java doc for PA2. I may require it for some of the later ones. But I would say get into the habit of using this anyway, right? And if you ever do Java in a workplace environment, you're almost certainly going to have to do something like this. And it's right there. There's no reason not to. All right, questions on any of that? All right, let's take a quick break, and then I want to talk about doing GUIs from Eclipse in Java. So take about 5 minutes, we'll come back about 1 o'clock.
Nick, could you get a refund on the importing project?
This is a Jensen now.
All right, let's talk about GUIs. So we want to be able to create interfaces to our Java code, right? So we want to make a program that will display graphical information or contain buttons or text boxes or things like that. And this is pretty easy to do in Java, and it's also pretty easy to do inside Eclipse using Java. So there's two pieces to what we're gonna do. One piece is called Swing. And Swing is a set of Java classes that let you do things like create a window that can hold buttons or a text box or sliders or things like that. So it's a collection of classes that'll let us do graphics. And all you need is Swing. You can be working from the command line using Java C to compile, and you can write code that uses Swing classes, but it's a fair amount of work. And some people prefer to teach this from the command line, where you're creating these classes using the constructors and setting up all the fields that you need and so on and so forth. And that's the way that I learned Swing. But I don't think it's time well spent at this point. So inside Eclipse is something called Window Builder. And this is basically a drag and drop interface that will write Swing code for you. Now you still need to know what these classes are in Swing. You need to know what a JFrame is. You need to know what the paint method is and so on. But it takes care of a lot of the sort of mundane low-level details and spares you from having to know, okay, these are the 15 things I have to do to create a window. I have to set its dimensions. I have to set its position. I have to set its background color, its foreground color, what it's going to do when it closes, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, and Window Builder will sort of take care of those things for us. So you need to set this up, and as usual, we're going to go under Help, Install New Software. And let me say what's already installed, because I've already got this installed on my system. And I got a lot of things installed. But you're going to want Swing Designer and Window Builder Core. So let's see if we can find this. So hide items that are already installed. Let's get rid of that. And work with, so this is the repository. So if you've done anything in Linux, it's the same kind of idea. So let's work with Oxygen. And under filter text, let's say Swing. Let's see if we can find it. This is assuming I still have a network connection. Okay, so Swing Designer is what you're going to want. So you're going to click that. You can put in the documentation if you want, and then click through to finish. And the other thing you're going to want is window builder. And so I would do all of these. I click through on those, and then you'll have a finish option. And if we hide what's already installed, it doesn't show up because it's already installed. Okay, so you do that once, okay, and that basically adds these things into Eclipse. So it creates the library of swing classes, and then it gives you the window builder tool. Okay, once you've done that once, you're all set from that point forward. It's a part of your Eclipse installation now.
I'm sorry, which piece of window builder did we want? Core?
Do all of it.
All of it?
Yeah, there's only like five or six of them.
Do we want to test window swing?
I don't think you need that one. Alright, so our life begins with a J-frame. And a J-frame is that window that you see anytime you're doing anything, right? This border around here with the buttons in the corner and something else in the upper left that you can click on and so forth. That's all a frame, okay, a window frame. There's a particular type of frame in Swing we're going to use called a J-frame. So let's just make a Java program that pops up a frame. Okay, so we're going to start the same as usual. File, new, Java project. Let's see, no, we're not. Yeah, Java project. Okay, so this is going to be called Swing Demo. And I'll just say finish. Okay, so now on that project, I'm going to say file new. And instead of saying class, I'm going to come down to other. And I'm going to come down to window builder. And I'm going to come down to swing designer. And I'm going to say J-frame. Okay, so file new. Other window builder, J swing designer, J-frame. Everyone got that? All right, and then it's going to ask me for the name. This is the name of my class, so I'll just call this my main J-frame. And I won't worry about the default package being discouraged, and I'll say finish. And I got some code, got a lot of code. Okay, so it's doing some imports for me. It's creating a class and it's saying this extends a J-frame. So I mentioned extensions very briefly last week, I think. The idea that you can take a class and you can make a new class that's an extension of it. Meaning that everything that's in this base class J-frame is now in this new class, my main J-frame. And when I say everything from here is available here, that means all the machinery and mechanisms that go into making a frame, controlling what happens when you move it around and resize and so on and so forth, all that stuff is part of this class that I'm writing right here. This is my main JFrame class. All right, we have a different way to start the code. So this is the main program now. And we don't need to worry about what any of this stuff means. There's several concepts going on here that we'll get to eventually. There's inner classes and there's runnables and threads and things like that. Don't worry about it, okay? This is the main program, and what it's gonna do is it's gonna construct a new my main J-frame. It's gonna make it visible. And then it's gonna exit, right? That's the end of the code. My main program's gonna exit. So what does the J-frame do? Well, right now, all it does is this. Says that when you close it, you should exit. Says it's 100 by 100, 450 by 300, sitting at 100 by 100. It sets some other stuff up in here. Again, none of this we need to worry about. Okay, let's just go ahead and run this. And there's a frame. And we can resize it, and we can move it around, and we can do what we want with it, we can maximize it, and we can demax it, and we can close it. And my program's running, right? There's this little red dot down here, red square saying that my program's running. if I close this frame, that grays out and now my program is exited. All right, so down here at the bottom, there's a pair of tabs. This tab that we're on right now says source. This tab says design. If you switch to that, now you're into the heart of the window builder system. Depending on the time of day, your operating system, what version of Eclipse you have, this can be flaky. Okay, so be prepared for the chance that sometimes things will crash. Okay, it's not you, it just happens sometimes. All right, well, what I have over here is a picture of what my frame looks like so far. It's just this frame, it's got these dimensions, and there's not a whole lot else going on. Over here, I have a palette of things that I can place onto my frame. I can place some containers like panels and toolbars. I can also place components like buttons and text fields and radio buttons and checkboxes and so on and so forth. And this is all pretty much drag and drop. Okay? But by default, if I grab a button and I try to drag it into here, it's not gonna like me right now. I don't know what's going on. I did something that it's unhappy with. And I can't even go back to source. And I can't right click. So like I said, sometimes. So I'm going to try to kill this. And I'm gonna restart it. My Eclipse installation in particular is a little goofy. I don't know why. I need to reinstall it one of these days. Why am I not charging? Because I'm unplugged. That's part of it. All right, so swing demo. Let's go back to the design window. All right, let's try running this again. Oh no, it's going to drop something. Okay, so let's grab a J button. And if you try to drop it, you get this weird little five-section region. And I can drop in any of these sections, but it's not what we really want. So there's an idea of a layout manager. Okay, a layout manager basically controls where you place things in something like a frame, some kind of container. And if you've noticed with most graphical things on a system, you'll have, you know, some buttons and some output windows and so on. If you resize the window, things move around. Right, if you go into Word, for example, you've got a toolbar on the top, you've got some menu options. If you make the window bigger, the toolbar might stretch out. And what used to be two lines might become one line. And if you make it really small, things might start stacking on each other and so on. That's all handled by something called a layout manager. Okay, and this is one of the layout managers, but it's not the one we want to work with for first versions of this. So before you start putting components on here, go to layouts, and click on Absolute Layout. Oh, I broke it again. Oh, this is not going to make me happy. Yeah. I have to figure out why this is happening. Well, okay, we'll try this one more time. I'm going to leave a window up so I can see what's going on. All right, so back to the design tab. So click on Absolute Layout. And come over here, and when you get that green border, just left click. And that should make an absolute layout. What that means is that when we place something in this window, it'll stay exactly where we place it. It won't move around, it'll be in a fixed position regardless of how we resize the window. So here's a J button, and I can drop this anywhere that I want. So there's a new button, and it'll let me change the name. So I can say, click me. And let's make a text field and put that right here. And I don't know, let's have a checkbox.
What's a J spinner
do? I think a J spinner is like a slider. I'm not sure why they call them spinners. All right, so I've designed a graphical interface here, and if I say run, there's my window. And it's got a button I can click and a checkbox I can click on or off, and a text field that I can do some typing into. Now what's actually going on in the background, all of this stuff. Right, so it's creating all this code. And if you know how these classes work, you don't need Window Builder, you can just type these in. Right, so you can construct a J button with a label that you want to appear, and you can set the bounds, the dimensions, and location. You can add it to this content pane, and same thing for a text field and a checkbox. Okay, but this way is easier, except when it crashes.
So if you want to give your, I don't know, 4-year-old a fake app,
mm-hmm.
you can make them, and they can just click it.
Yeah,
it doesn't do anything.
Absolutely. Or you can record everything that they do, and then like analyze them later.
So if we know how to write the class, so I mean, then we can just write the class in the text. But these are,
yeah. Now this won't work directly over PuTTY, because when we run PuTTY to the server, we've got a serial communication line, right? It's not graphical. But you can open an X Windows, you can say SSH-X, and it'll actually, if you run an X server on your machine, it will let you pop up graphical interfaces from code running on a remote server. We can go over how to do that another time. But this works best if you're on your own system. But it is portable. All right, so over here, and I don't have an easy way to make this text bigger. Over here, you can get information about each of these things that you've put into your window. So for example, if I click on the Click Me button, it'll show me the name of this object is button Click Me, right? And in the source code, you can see that. That's what it called this object. And it'll show you basic characteristics of it, okay? So what the font is that it's using. And if I want to change the font, I can break my setup. I knew that was going to happen. There's a little button down here you can click on, and it'll give you the usual font selection dialog. You can change the font. You can change the size of the font. You can oh, there we go. So let's use
Dingbats.
Dingbats is usually good. Let's do like, yeah, but it doesn't have any text in it. I thought it would be like Wingdings, but it's not. Yeah. How about Font Awesome? That looks great. Free mono, and we'll do it italic, and we'll make it big. All right, so there's a fancy font, and we can change colors. So I don't know, let's use red. So now it says Click Me in red, and so on and so forth, right? So you can change all these aspects of what this button looks like, including the alignment, the text itself. You can put on icons, you can have tooltips, so that when you hover, I don't know, I never tried this one. So let's run this. So if I hover, it'll give me the tooltip, right? Tell you to click it. Yeah, don't touch this. Yeah, you can make it your own shape, and you can pop an icon in there instead, and so on. And these are the simple properties. If you go up here, you can say show advanced properties, and you get all these other options as well. Okay, so you could probably take a whole course just on a J button, right? We could certainly spend a few days just learning about all the ways to use a J button, but you don't need to, right? It can be as simple as, you know, give it a name. So if I want to,
Sorry, it's
not J tree. Oh yeah. So if I want to call it something, I'm just going to call it a clicker. Okay. So now if I look at my source code, the J button is called clicker. Okay, so a general thing about Window Builder, be really careful changing things in here. Okay. It is reverse engineering this code every time that you say, show me what the layout is. And if you change that code in a way that it doesn't think it understands, it'll give you an error message. Right, and sometimes it gives you that error when there's actually nothing wrong. That's one of the flaky things. But you got to be careful how you change things over here. Okay, but there are some places where we'll change because actually we haven't written any code yet, right, which is why this doesn't do anything. Okay, so this is all crash course, right? We'll spend more time on these. But let's just play with this. So this is called a text field. Let me give that a different name. Let me call it output. Okay, so I have a thing called output, and that's a J text field. And I have a thing called click me, and that's a J button. And a J button is actually an abstract button, which is a J component, which is a container, which is a component, which is an object. Right, so hierarchies. Yeah. So let's look at some of this. So what's a J button? It's just a class. And we already saw how to construct it. We can construct it with a string that becomes the button's label, or a string and an icon, or just an icon, etc. And it's got some methods, not a whole lot though. So it's mostly ways to condition the button. But the interesting question is, how do we connect an action to this so that if the person clicks on the button, something happens? And there's no method in here for, you know, do something when click happens. So this is another big change of gears from procedural programming in C. So in Java, what we tend to be doing is what's called event-driven programming. And take a look at our main program. So our main program is up here. There's not a lot going on in there. It creates a frame. It calls the setVisible method, which makes it appear. If an error happens, it prints a stack trace. If the error doesn't happen, it comes out of the try block, and that's it. And your main method actually exits almost immediately when you run your program. So if your main method is gone, how does anything happen? We set things up so that when certain events occur, certain pieces of code are fired in response. Okay, it's kind of like an interrupt-driven model, but it's a software analog. In an interrupt version of programming, you arm your interrupts, you write your interrupt code, you set up the interrupt vectors, all this 270 stuff. And then, you know, your main loop is just branch to myself, right? It just sits there and spins. Well, in this case, our main loop doesn't even exist, right? It just exits. But when something happens that causes one of these events to occur, we'll have set up some code to come into action. So event-driven programming will be a theme throughout this. Okay, so we have an output thing called output, and we have a button called clicker. Okay, so I'm going to right-click on my button, and there's an option for add event handler. And under add event handler, I'm going to, let's see, I don't know if that's what I want. I'm not convinced, but let's try this. So we'll add an event handler for an action called action performed. Okay, now it's bringing me into a section of my code with a cursor right here. That's telling me it wants me to write some code here. And when this action is performed, this method called action performed is going to be executed. So let's just put a message in here and see if this is really making sense. So I'm just going to print out a message on my console that says I'm inside the action performed method. And that's all I'm going to do. So let's see if this happens when we click the button. So let's run this. Nothing happens with that. Nothing happens with this. Click the button, and there's my message. So every time I click the button, this line of code is executing. All right, so we can notice when button gets clicked. So let's use this text box. So this is called a JText field. And it's another Java class. And it's already constructed for us, but it's got some methods. So what are some of the methods? Well, there's one in particular which is, nope, there's not. So we gotta be a little subtle. Remember, the JText field is a JText component, which is a J component, a container, a component, and an object, right? Everything's extended from other things. Okay, so the methods that are listed here are the methods that are particular to the JText field. But a JText field has all the methods coming from those other classes that it extends. And those methods are listed below here more succinctly. So because a JText field is a JText component, it also has all of these methods. And because it's a J component, it also has all of these methods, and all of these, and all of these, and all of these. So it's got a lot of methods in there, right? But this page is not going to document most of those. If you want to know about one of these methods, look at the documentation for container. Okay, so it'll give you details on the things that are particular to a JText field. But it's also a JText component, and if we look at JText component, there's a method called setText. So let's take a look at that. And setText takes a string argument, returns nothing, and it says set the text of this text component to the specified text. So some of this is trial and error, right? I mean, you can get a book and you can read all this and you can read for 5 years before you write any code, but that's not fun, right? Trial and error is a whole lot more fun. So the theory is that there is a setText method associated with this object, which is called output, that we can use to put some text in here. So let's try that. So I'm going to get back to my code by just double clicking on the click button. So I'm inside action method performed, and let's say output.setText. And we'll say yay. And if we didn't know exactly what we were doing, we could say output dot, and it'll show me all the possible methods that I could call as part of this object class. And we can scroll through there. There's a get text and so on. And eventually you would find a set text. And it would show you the kinds of things that it's expecting. So there's, it's going to be somewhere else. But yeah, so you could start it. Oh, come on, man. I can't make it talk to me now. Anyway, trial and error. All right. So presumably, when we click the button, it'll change the text in that JText field. So let's run that. Yes.
You said to be careful about like messing around with coding these things. In general, would you prefer for us to write it like that or use like the interface? I don't know if there's a way to like tie those two components together in the interface that they have, like with the drag and drop interface.
No, you gotta write code eventually.
Okay.
And you're encouraged, right, and required to edit code in this source file, right, to make it work. But when you select an action or you double click a button or whatever, it will bring you into your file and it will create an outline for whatever it is that you need to create, and you're totally free to change code inside that block, right? But what you don't want to do, and I lost my interface again, what you don't want to do is come up here, for example, and change the order of two lines or start changing arguments randomly, right? If you really know what you're doing and you want to change the color, I could come down here and I could just change that red to green and probably be fine, right? And when I switch back to the design view, it'll show me green text instead of red. So you can definitely change this, but it's got to be able to reverse engineer it in a way that it understands. So if you start changing formatting of the code or breaking lines up or things like that, you might trip it up. Okay, it's limited in its sophistication, but certainly things like this, where we definitely want to write the code, that works fine. Well, I crashed Eclipse again, and there we go. Okay, so I'll cancel it. Yeah, exactly. So let's close that out. Let's stop that. I might have to actually close it. Okay, we'll close it. There's a great message. How does the code know the size to allocate?
Is this what you would use if you're writing a graph?
It's what I've used in the past, but honestly, I haven't used it under Linux in a while. But I learned a system called NetBeans originally, and it's like Swing, it's just a different version of being able to drag and drop. But this may be one of these things that's actually more solid under Windows than under Linux. All right, so there's our window. Let's go ahead and click it, and it shows me some text. Yay. Okay, well, we can make this a little more interesting. So, and I can change some stuff in the beginning of my class. So, let's make a number called num. And when I click my button, let's set the text equal to a message that says num equals and increment the value of num and put that out next to it. And so I run this, and now every time I click the button, it increments my counter in my text field. Best clicker, we could call it cake clicker or something. All right, so the goal of all of this, like I say, we'll go through the details more carefully, right, as we go forward. But the goal here is to get across the idea that A, this is a very easy system to work with, right? It's drag and drop. You have these components, you can go to the Java documentation and find all the details about J buttons, text field, checkboxes, and so on and so forth. But you don't necessarily need to get that up close with them to make use of them. Okay, there's usually a button, you want a way to click it, you want a way to respond to the click text field, you might want to read text from it, you might want to put text out to it, and so on. But there's a lot of layers beyond that that we can use. And everything is an object, right? So button, checkbox, text field, those are all objects. The whole JFrame is an object too. And if you look at a JFrame, what is it? Yeah, it's a frame, window, container, etc., etc. So you can construct it with a title, if you like. There's also a set title method that you can use to put a title on top. So now when we click, right, we're inside a JFrame right now, so if we just say something like set title yay, there's our frame, click the button, there's where our title goes. So you want to keep in mind everything's an object, right, which means it comes with methods and such. And you really just write the code to sort of glue these things together. So if you wanted to make a calculator program, right, you could make 10 buttons, you could label them 0 through 9, and when you click a button, you have some number, multiply by 10, add whatever that digit is for that button to it. That lets you enter numbers, and you take that number that you've entered so far and you display it in the text field, and now you can toggle in a number. And when you hit the plus button, right, you take the number you've entered so far and you save it somewhere, and you go on like that, right? And it's just coding at that point. You're not worried about any of the details of making buttons and displays and things like that. So some of these things are more obvious than others. If I right click on this checkbox and I say add event handler, I can get an action performed, which is when I've clicked it. I can also say state changed, which will tell me if it's gone from checked to unchecked or vice versa. And if we look at JCheckbox, well, let's just explore it. So let's add event handler, state changed. So it's passing me, in this case, an argument, which is a change event. It's calling it arg0, it could be anything that I want. And if you look up a change event, got a toString method, so let's just print this out. So let's just print out the argument inside here. This and there's some stuff happening. So when I move my mouse over this, I'm triggering a state changed event. When I move away from it, I'm triggering a state changed event. And when I click, I'm triggering several events. So let's make this bigger. I can't change the size. All right. So it's giving me all this information. Right, so this is the result of toString inside that argument. And one of these will tell you if it's checked or not. So at that point, you go to the documentation, and you dig, and you find out how to read the current state, whether it's checked or unchecked.
All right, some general questions. I'm skipping most of the details.
How often are we going to be using GUIs for our assignments?
Definitely for assignment 3, which will be a game, and possibly for assignment 4, which I haven't decided what you're going to do. But in general, I'm going to give you the option to use this going forward. So if we're doing something that can be done with a command line interface, but you want to make a GUI for it, that's cool. Right? And I'm thinking of assignment 5, which will be like a chat client. It's more fun to have it with a GUI front end. And really, once you do this a few times, it becomes second nature. Right? It's really just sort of learning the set of widgets, buttons, checkboxes, text fields, things like that. And depending on what system you're using, those widgets may change, right? But if you're using Swing, you learn that set of objects and you're good to go, that set of classes. And if you're using NetBeans, you learn a different set and you go from there.
All right, what else do I want to tell you about this? Anything? Yeah, let's look at mouse. So here's my JFrame itself. Let's add an event handler for mouse, and let's say mouse clicked. Okay, so this is a method inside the main JFrame, and it gives me an arg0 argument again. And arg0, I say arg0 dot, and there's all the methods I might use. And the second and third ones are getX and getY, which sound promising. So let's do arg0 getX plus comma plus arg0 dot get y. Does have to be uppercase. It's one line of code, right? And if I run this and I come in here and I click my mouse, I'm getting mouse coordinates. So now we can respond to mouse actions, which is kind of cool.
Is that just for the window or for the whole screen?
So that's just for the window, right? Because I put it inside the JFrame. So if I come outside, I'm being captured by whatever the window is. There's my little window. What if I'm inside here? Right, it's responding to that. And let's see, add event handler, mouse. There should be a mouse motion. Oh yeah, mouse motion, okay. Let's do mouse motion, mouse moved. And same thing down here. I'm just going to copy this line of code. I'll just put a message there saying we're moving. And run that. And now anytime I'm moving around my window, I'm getting an event. And I can make my window big and right, and this is relative to the window, so up here I'm close to 0, 0. And if I move it over here, that's still close to 0, 0, so it's relative to the J frame. Right, so we need to learn details of all of these components, right, and some of the nuances of picking these things up, but we can do the same thing for keystrokes. So you can say if you're sitting in this window and you hit a key, what do you want to do? And you can trigger an event and get the keystroke that the person used. And there's lots of details to that. For example, we can get the ASCII code or we can get the actual key code so we know if they hit left control versus right control.
So is that where you get stuff like on most computers, if you hit like the arrow keys, you'll shift around different objects or windows on
yeah.
the screen?
So you can capture all of that and respond to it. And we need to talk about painting, and painting is a whole other subject, being able to actually draw things pixel by pixel. And there's some weird details to that. Okay, so that's a totally separate discussion. But this is enough to get you going through the basics. And I should have like a 15-minute video somewhere on my YouTube channel, a quick intro to Swing, if you just search the channel for Swing. That sort of talks you through the highlights of this without the repeated crashing of the software. All right, so we'll dig further into this on Wednesday. And I'll see if I can stabilize my Eclipse setup in the meantime.